Thank you so much for staying. My name is Jennifer Edwards. I am a scholar in residence here. I'm also the director producer of Pillow Voices. So if you are not familiar with our podcast, please find us on iTunes and every place you stream your podcast. I mentioned this tonight because our most recent episode is on Liz Lerman. So if you'd like some listening options on your way home, please tune in. So, thank you. One of the most amazing parts of being a scholar here at Jacob's Pillow is you get to see the show multiple times. And so, you know, third time tonight, and I'm still seeing new things.
Much as I've seen it, we've only done it four times, there'll be two more people coming out there just taking care of themselves, yeah.
I did want to plant a couple of seeds based on our conversation prior to this. So we're going to have some questions amongst the three of us, then we'll open it up to questions from the audience, from all of you. But in our conversation, Liz, you were talking about always being interested in where thinking and feeling connect for audience members, and hearing any of those reflections or moments. So I'll plant those seeds ahead of time, and you all can think about it while we vamp up here. So. You know, in prepping for this, I was listening to a lot of the conversations that you've had over the 7 years of work on this piece. And three inquiry questions kept coming up that I wonder if you could talk a little bit about. And that is about knowledge. What knowledge is celebrated? What knowledge is erased? And what knowledge is criminalized? So maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
And also, just thank you for being here, for giving us your time, for sitting in the rain with us, which was kind of fun, actually. There's a little zine that we also made that you can pick up at the store, but it has some of this in it. But when I saw that exhibit of these pictures, 500 years of drawings of witches, it was at first, hi you guys, hi Ruby, hi Bondo, bravo, bravo, bravo. The question on the floor right now is about knowledge systems. And when I dove into all the stuff about the witches, you know, I began to just this, there's an amazing book written in the 70s by Barbara Ehrenreich that poses the possibility of why all of those witches were killed at that time was the professionalization of medicine and that it was moving to the universities. And so it was important to stop the kind of rural kind of medicine or pagan medicine or unknown medicines or whatever, put a stop to it. It's a really interesting idea, but it got me, it kind of pulled together ideas about, well, what are knowledge systems, including the embodiment knowledge systems that the people you saw tonight have. This coincided with my being recruited to be full-time at a university. That's a laughing line, actually. But I mean, I love being at universities and have been a visiting artist at many, including Wesleyan. People are here tonight from Wesleyan. I just had such an amazing, that's how I met Pam Tadgy. But being full-time also put me in relationship to systems that are categorizing knowledge all the time, based on all kinds of things, including, well, who brings in the most research dollars, for example. So in a way, it set the stage for this question: why is there so much erasure of amazing, amazing knowledge? And for those of us that are as old as I am now, in my 70s, we already feel and see it. We know that the things that we used to know are gone, or even the things that we thought we had put out in the world would stay for, you know, would stay at least this many years, gone, gone. But more importantly, the criminalization question. Because that really is that is what we see all around us all the time right now. We are living in an era of that. and the speed with which somebody is criminalized just for something they said or did, pretty fast. So that is kind of a subset of all this.
I do want to welcome Ruby Morales and Will Bond. Yes, yes.
I do too.
And I would love to talk a little bit about this process. You know, Liz is a master of process. I think you've written 3 books on it and a 4th book as well. So I would love to learn a little bit about the process of making this piece. It is dense and rich and amazing. And so what has it been like to be inside of it for all this time?
Okay, I'll start. I will answer the question by telling 2 stories. One is that when one of the first rehearsals that Liz and I had, right before I started even dancing or moving, we talked for like an hour. That was part of our rehearsal. We sat and we talked. And we checked in about how I was doing, what was happening in my life, how my family was. And then right before I even started moving, Liz reminded me that the movement that I was about to offer was mine. And that anything that I did in that moment, because I was, exploring my own personal stories and exploring my own personal history, that anything that I did in that moment, if I, at any moment I said, you know what, I actually don't want it in the piece anymore, I don't feel comfortable, that I could, that I had that permission to do that. And so that was very, very important. That was a very important moment. So that's one story to answer the question about the process. Another story, today, the duet that I did with Vincent, I learned it this morning. and yeah, that felt like a really big test of how do we continue to show up for each other. And when there's a moment where I could have said, this is gonna be too difficult for me and I am too scared and I am too nervous, how do we continue to show up? And even in a moment of tension and a moment of difficulty, what does it look like to pass those boundaries and show up?
Well, yeah, so thank you for saying that, because that's now a part of the layering of this piece now. It's incredible. The density comes partially because we've been working together off and on through the pandemic, have to stop. We're not really out of the pandemic, but we're trying, all of us. And so there's a lot of personal, private life has changed. Lots of families have changed. People have gotten wounded and sick and come back. And so, you know, It's very super personal. The anthropology of it, you know, the layering of it, is true. And what else could I say? The first thing I learned was the alphabet, the witch's alphabet. Did you talk about that yet? So I was just getting to meet Liz, and one of the first things that we did was deal with our rage, or Liz's rage. And she wanted to teach us how to embody it without hurting ourselves. You know, just getting mad and being that way for 5 years. maybe a little bit I am, but and what we did was we built these shapes and these gestures that you see throughout the piece, which we called the alphabet, the witch's alphabet, and a lot of the material comes out of, you know, the letter A or the letter B. And it was a way to, I just think it's genius, it's a way to build vocabulary, of which we have a great deal, and deal with self-care and healing in very trying times. And that that's something about working with Liz Lerman, I think, and everything you're teaching us. So
the one thing I'll say about how long it's taken, when I was younger, I would make maybe 3 pieces a year. Later, it was, 3 years to make a piece. This one extended in part from the pandemic, in part for other reasons too. I started this work when I was living in Baltimore, and then Freddie Gray was murdered. And honestly, I just didn't think this was the piece for my community. And partly that's why I would put it away for a while. I was working on something else when then I ended up being out in Arizona. And maybe I wish it hadn't taken so long, I kind of like that it has. I just feel it's had such a chance to develop and grow. The story has changed. Parts of it have stuck, but we had to keep changing it because the world kept changing. And I think also the group of us, because when I had a company for 30 years, it's really, really different than when you're an independent choreographer and you're bringing people together. It's just such a different thing. And watching us all grow together and continue to have, I'm glad it's taken this long.
So maybe one last question, and then we'll open it up. I hope folks have been thinking about that thinking and feeling question. So this question is for you, Liz. How do you build the muscles to stay in this process for this amount of time? And I mean, you have such generosity, obviously, with your collaborators. I'm curious about those muscles, those staying research muscles.
Well, I keep telling people I was really lucky, and I think we all were, to live with witches during the pandemic. What is a better subject than to have in your companion when you're trying to sleep or read or take a walk? I mean, it turned out to be such a fantastic sphere of possibilities, from, of course, the magic to the science, from the feminism to questions of gender and sexuality, from the history, a whole question of forgiveness. So, for example, that section grew out of a 3-day residency at Harvard with Martha Minow, who was at the time the dean of the Harvard Law School, who had written a book called Between Vengeance and Forgiveness, which I had used in another project. And she was on it. She had decided to come back to forgiveness. Meanwhile, Leah Cox and I had been carrying on a long conversation about being white women right now and what that meant. And we were, this is the thing, and this is why it's so interesting. We had long conversations, each of the people and I, trying to find the personal connection in their life for which it would make sense to stay in this. And each of those was its own set of research and its own set of, dilemmas. And then we would come together and try to figure it out. So I feel actually lucky. I also, this is a weird question, but sometimes when people say to me, who am I like as an artist? Sometimes I say John Cage. And I say that not because I really am like John Cage at all. We really make different art. But I think a lot of people liked his ideas and his process, not necessarily his art, but he wouldn't have made the art he wouldn't have the ideas if he didn't make the art. I mean, he wouldn't have been able to think if he didn't make the art. That's how I feel. I know I'm a good thinker, but I wouldn't have been able to think this stuff if we weren't together trying to suffer through it all, occupying all those regions of things, which is why I spend so much time at my university and other places trying to bring embodiment, not necessarily dancing, but embodiment back into the world, because we really need it to think.
So I'd love to open it up to all of you. We did have this invitation to share any moments of thinking and feeling and impact in that realm. In your personal experience, but you can also ask other questions. I see a hand up. The question is, what is Liz the witch of?
Well, every minute, every second, it changes, because we're shapeshifters. But I would say today I am the witch of the remarkable nature of the dancers who come with me. I'm in awe. I guess I would say the witch of awe.
So the question is about how the piece was set up. Audience starting in the movement space, in the stage space, and then being moved back or around the space, and how intentional that relationship is between the performers, the questioners, and the audience in the setup.
I'll tell you the thinking a little bit about it, and then they can tell you what it's been like to do. But I'm interested from our perspective, whether you felt you sat differently through the performance because of that first 20 minutes. What was it like then as we proceeded to make it more and more proscenium? But part of it came up because during the pandemic, when we were thinking about coming back, I kept thinking, what could the witches do to make it easier for people to come back? Was kind of my thought. And the second thought was, I think people are going to need intimacy and spectacle. That our spectacle had been reduced to what was on the computers, and our intimacy, as we know, what we all went through. So I thought, what could we do to make that? And that's why we set up this idea of these little groupings, you'd be together, but that eventually it would get to the kind of spectacle that we kind of got in the second act. But what do you guys want to say about that?
I feel like we all individually have our own ways of creating intention about how we're going to approach the situation. But I think on the as a person who was helping to facilitate the movement, I think of it as no one is a bystander. That everybody plays a role in everything that happens, and even when you're thinking about a mistake that someone might make, or when something happens in the world, y'all aren't bystanders. We're not bystanders. We play a role in the way that this world is developing.
Yeah, I kind of a big and a small thing. One is the big question for all of us, you know, the crew back there and all of us here is, and probably you've had this in your own work life, for example, you know, the new normal conversation, you know, what in the world are we doing here now? Honestly, like re-interrogate that. And so that was something that Liz put to us, and I think it relates to, okay, we're just going to do away with the normal audience situation and really ask, what are you doing here? You know, and the other thing is, as you say, there was a moment in time, particularly with my persona in the piece, we had this little conversation about who's guilty, who's on trial. You know, and in a way, we're all guilty and we're all on trial and trying to sort that business out. And then finally, I would say that for me, it's fun because you cast yourselves as witches, and it kind of takes out the hierarchy of we're the performers and you're not, or whatever that relationship is. And it actually just takes the pressure off a little bit, that we're all kind of in an even playing field. That makes me happy.
The comment was, most witches in movies do things that we can't do. They fly, they're invisible. But these witches in this show could do things, or all did things that we could do. And so that was the comment. And I think there's more to be said.
Yeah, no, this is why I love them flying on stools. and actually, when some of us may feel we live in a time where there's not a lot of hope, the fragility of that ending is, to me, exactly in the moment.
The question is about moments found that maybe were decided by the group that it should be kept private or not shared publicly. But what was it like to find that and to maybe make that decision not to share it?
Yeah, the answer is yes. I can't think of a specific example, and probably if I did, I wouldn't want to share it. But we definitely did have moments where, as Ruby alluded to earlier, one of the performers would, or Liz would say, actually, no, you can't have that. That's not appropriate anymore. That definitely happened, yeah.
Yeah, I think that that's connected to some conversations that we've actually had about, because these stories are very personal, and because I may have, my identity allows me to experience the world, it allows me to experience the world differently than other people who may identify differently. And so the question became, when does it become appropriation of my experiences and my stories, and when does it become, when does it allow for other people to see themselves in me? And so having conversations about that, and I feel that's where, even for myself, asking myself that question as well, like when does it feel that, yeah, that I'm crossing the line, even if I feel like I may be a person that feels very giving, it's important for me to ask myself that question, and we would have those conversations. It would show up more in that kind of space of when does it become appropriation, and when does it become me sharing something that I hope that others can see themselves in.
I spent most of my life in making work in which everyone collaborates in the making. But the question is, how do you honor all the gifts that arrive? And to some extent, how do you acknowledge blame when there's a problem? Both things are difficult in collaborations, but the one we're focusing on right now is the gifts that the artists bring. And in this particular group, it's not just the stories, it's the way they move, it's their family histories. It's the way they do theater, or the way they have performed all their lives. Many of them come from major companies, and they have a whole other set of histories. There was a while when Bondo's role was going to be a collector, and he was collecting witches because he wanted their knowledge. That was an early version. And I moved away from that because I felt it didn't give the witches enough agency. Actually, gave him all the agency. But I did at times feel like a collector myself. And then what? So taking care to be sure that people felt they owned the material, that they could take the material back, that we could test it and say, no, this isn't right, that it might exist. That's why I'd love you to get the zine, because there are things that we decide not to do here, but we write about later, or we talk about them in this kind of a thing, or they might appear on the podcast or something like that. So a lot of, sometimes, but I just, all that takes a lot of time, but that's when you introduce me as a person of process. Process is a product in its own way. If you practice it, it's a thing. And that thing is part of why we could do this.
So the question is about extinction. The comment was, it seemed like a lot of extinction in the piece was focused on animals or nature. And so then the question becomes, are there times when witches faced extinction through witch hunts and genocides? And is this an act, perhaps, of preservation?
It's a really lovely, I like the idea of that it's an act of preservation, I don't think, the thing about the word witch, and Nia says it in her, I'm not a witch, that's what you call me, I'm not that. So it's not, I've turn to it as a form of, love and possibility, all the things about magic and all that, that just seem wonderful to me. And less about the evil side that things get named, but I think we'll have them. Maybe it's worth saying that I was worried that I was appropriating witches, because there are a lot of people who are witches and I'm not, and the question about what story you can tell when you're not a witch. And I was having this conversation with Ava de Asantewa, who is a witch, and she said to me, how do you know you're not a witch, Liz? that sort of took care of the business for me.
I want to thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you all so much. Thank you for sharing your work.
I will pray for one